Chris is going to do a quick recap of the solutions and give us sort of a side-by-side comparison of them after we've gone through all three here, and just sort of let you digest what we've covered today. So, Chris, go ahead and take it away.
Great. Thanks, Brad. Thanks, Jeremy. Thanks, Bill. Great overview presentations. I'm assuming that you're seeing the recap now, Brad.
Yep, looks like it.
You should be. So, again, as you've seen, you know, a pretty good competition here between us and the team and the three solutions. And this is going to be pushed out content. But if you look at this and you're like, okay, where's the big differentiating factors? And as, you know, our organization engages with companies, you know, we start with ambition requirements, really boiling down, what do you do today? What are you using today? What's the shortcomings? Why are we looking at change? And a lot of times it's legacy. It's old. We can't integrate. We can't augment. We can't expand it. There's limited support. Maybe it's discontinued. Maybe the server's dying and the old stuff won't run a new system. But as you look at the checkboxes and you think 365 and finance and operations and Business Central run pretty close. And there are differentiating features. And just because there's a checkbox, you know, for example, in production planning and execution does not mean the two solutions are equal. Likewise, as far as Dynamics GP, like, oh, they all have that. Not to the same degrees. And so again, this is a very high-level macro view of differentiators. But as you do the deeper dive into these products, we really start exposing why would we pick one over the other? And it may be organizational size. You know, somebody comes in and says, how big is your company? Well, we're on QuickBooks today. Most QuickBooks companies do not move to finance and operations. Business Central is a great candidate there, so is Dynamics GP. But finance and operations starts at 20 users, and we'll talk about that in a second. So a lot of times the organization size is going to limit what they should really consider for an option, but it's also going to be feature functionality. If you tell me that, hey, we're doing process manufacturing, you know, I may look at Business Central before I look at GP. I can add process manufacturing to GP as an add-on, but it's native in Business Central. Then again, you may be a $500 million company and we'll look at finance and operations compared to maybe a $25 million company that we'd recommend to Business Central. So again, fit, you know, what's the best solution? There are a number of criteria, and it's not just feature function, but size of the organization, but as well as where do we want to end up? And I've got groups that have been acquired by private equity, and they may be doing $30 million, but they're positioning, and as Bill indicated, land and expand. Many companies want to move onto this platform to be ready for the next 3 to 5 years of growth and ambition, and to have the application features that can support any ambition, and the customer, and the employee, and the vendor experiences, and have those be native functions. And so again, a lot of stuff is native in the big product. Finance and operations, the hero product. Business Central, though, as we look at the migration of the traditional on-prem division solution into Business Central is going to continue to grow in terms of feature set. Microsoft continues to buy intellectual property and embed it into these applications. As they continue to enhance the Microsoft Cloud, people inherit those capabilities. They just show up. Dynamics GP's new release, it's connected to Business Central, aka the intelligent cloud, the intelligent edge. So they're taking the GP customers and giving them a pipeline into the cloud to light up artificial intelligence and predictive analytics. And a lot of those things that, you know, again, may not have been in reach for a GP customer that's on-prem. But again, a lot of blur between the solutions. So again, we recommend that have the conversation with us. Let us help go through our matrix of how do we decide which solution do we look at based on your organization. Again, another comparison here, and this one gets a little, you've heard a little bit about pricing, but as you look at sizing, core capabilities, again, GP is loaded. I mean, there's a lot there. Business Central's loaded. Now, again, you know, in finance and operations, even more loaded. So again, we're looking at, okay, what's the sizing? User minimums, you know, user max. GP says no max. However, you know, if you ask Microsoft, you tell them you have 100 users, they want you to look at finance and operations. They're going to put a limit on the Business Central application. I don't know if it's 100 or if it's 200, but there will be a cap, which means that if you think you're going to have 300 users, Business Central is going to fall out of favor. GP would fall out of favor at 300 users also. You need to be more on the finance and operations. Configuration behind these things, you know, as we look at pricing, you know, you can see GP, the SaaS license could be from 125 to 350. And there's waterfall pricing is what's going on there. That hosting and the SaaS model is through partner, and that's it. A small footprint, multi-tenant can be very small. A small footprint, single tenant could be more per user. A larger user count, single tenant, the price is dropping in that type of a fashion. There are people that buy GP and have it hosted. There's people that buy GP and put it on-prem. Mathematically, you know, from an ROI, subscription and SaaS model is going to be cheaper on a five-year total ROI than it is to do, you know, Cal licensing and pay software assurance and then actually pay for application maintenance. Application maintenance is embedded into the SaaS model. As we switch to the Business Central, price point is very attractive. And as we think about total cost of ownership in the cloud, it's multi-tenant, which means there is no maintenance. So again, there's an advantage over GP because GP is going to have maintenance, whether it's, you know, in a single tenant model, but you know, NAV is not in that. Now, when we go on premise with Business Central, it is the traditional NAV product, which has all that feature functionality. So on-prem Business Central is going to have more capability than the cloud Business Central today. In another year or so, Microsoft's going to continue to close that gap as the developers in Europe continue to migrate the on-prem nav features to Business Central. But today, Business Central is very robust. And you might say, well, what's missing? Again, we have to dig in with the consultants as we look at feature functionality that may tell us, well, GP may be more robust in the payroll area than Business Central today. So again, you see the price comparisons. Finance and operations, minimum 20 users. That disqualifies small companies a lot of times. They don't want to pay for licensing they're not going to use. But the top end, we've got 1,000 user installations out there, and it scales very, very well. Again, you see the pricing there. There's per user. There's on-prem pricing. Again, you see the implementation range is very interesting. As we talk about starter pack or what's called more of a quick start or a jump start, however you want to do it, and there's people that want to take these applications and stand them up for a small budget. And, you know, we've showed 240 hours. We've got people that are doing even smaller footprint implementations of that with GP and Business Central. As we move over to finance and operations, it's a big animal. And again, you're thinking, wow, 1,000 hours. Can you do a smaller footprint? We've got some people that want to stand up limited functionality, and it's below 1,000 hours. At the end of the day, if you're implementing finance and supply chain, it's going to be a 1,000-hour-plus project. So what we don't want to do is don't want people to think finance and operations is something they can buy and get in there for, you know, under 100,000, because a 20 user license times 190 is close to 50 grand a year for subscription. You add 1,000 hours, boom, all of a sudden you're a $250,000 price tag to do a finance and operations project, which again, is that the starter, the jump start? Again, we can get them a little bit smaller than that as people compromise, you know, complexity. So again, it really depends. Is it a basic org? Is it a complex org? And it really depends on what you're replacing, because as we look at what's phase one is those core set of features that you use today, because you can't lose any of that as you transition to a new solution. So our team is very diligent about mapping current feature functionality, phase two ambition feature functionality to make sure it's all in the solution and there's a project management aspect that kind of guides you through that. Target org size, again, you know, we don't have revenue on here, but certainly revenue should be something in here, but 3 to 100 employees, 5 to 250, 20 to 1,000 plus, you get the idea. Small and mid-size, upper mid-market enterprise. Again, what's your growth curve? What are we preparing for as we look at the solutions? Replacing ERP is not an 18-month to 24-month ambition. It is a 5-plus-year ambition. You do not want to come back and revisit an ERP replacement, probably for 10 years. All of these solutions give you that ability to kind of implement them, land and expand, and continue to augment and implement new features through a variety of different mechanisms. Again, deployment options, you can see that all of these are cloud option and on-prem. Unique thing about GP is it's through partner. Microsoft does not offer their public cloud for Dynamics GP. However, GP can be deployed on Azure and managed through partner. And certainly there's the on-premise installation model. Business Central, multi-tenant public cloud, again, maintenance administration baked into that pricing. It's a great value proposition. It's multi-company, multi-entity, a lot of neat stuff going on there. I think that you're going to see, you know, big adoption of that product. From a penetration, I don't think it was mentioned, I said GP has 50,000 installs. You know, the NAV has more like 100,000 plus. So majority in Europe, because that's where it originated from. Again, we move over to the finance and operations. There's going to be a smaller penetration count, but they're much larger organizations that are using that. Again, public Azure cloud, single tenant. Okay, it's not a multi-tenant app. That means there is going to be maintenance in there. Again, they are offering an on-premise hybrid mode. So all of them support customizations, extensibility. All of them plug into the Microsoft cloud, some more than others. GP does it through one mechanism, but Business Central certainly lives there. Finance and operations lives there. And again, as you look at the application maintenance line. So a lot of information. There's certainly a lot more that we want to share with organizations that are really ready to engage in again, let's call it the discovery process. Trials are available in the Business Central. Again, we can stand up trials for GP. There are paid trials around finance and operations. People want to go through, give me a trial, let's do a proof of concept. So there's a lot of approaches into evaluating these, again, as we go from requirements to let's get vision sessions, let's get proof of concept, let's do pro forma budgeting. Again, this process can take anywhere from 60 days. We've got people that take a year to go through selection decisions and finally get ready to implement these solutions. So again, we're very interested in having serious conversations with you. And I think at this point, there's time for Q&A. So I will go ahead and stop there. And Brad, if you want to facilitate Q&A, again, thanks again, everybody, for participating today. And we look forward to follow-up conversations.
Thank you, Chris. Yeah, as Chris said, please feel free to submit your questions now. And as Rokas touched on earlier in the introduction, there is a lot to consider when you're choosing a new ERP solution for your business. It's your core mission-critical solution, and so it's definitely not something that we recommend that you take lightly. There are numerous stakeholders involved in your organization, as well as your goals for digital transformation to consider and what your vision looks like for your business and for your IT model. And so on that note, we highly recommend that you take advantage of the ERP Fit Gap session that we're offering for attendees of this webinar. It is a four-hour session with Turnkey Technologies where both our teams will sit down and discuss your goals, see what you have in mind for the future, and what will solve your immediate pain points now. And at the very least, you know, if you don't decide to go with a Microsoft ERP solution, this Fit Gap session will give you a very solid idea of where you want to take your research and sort of what's out there in the market and what's available and the different size solutions being offered from Microsoft. So please take advantage of your special offer for the ERP Fit Gap session. And just a reminder, we will be sending out an email tomorrow that will have the recording on it as well as our PowerPoint presentations. It will also have a link to the ERP Fit Gap offer and our contact information. So please feel free to contact us if you have questions. We'd be happy to help, and we would be happy to take you through the process of evaluating your requirements for your next ERP solution. Thank you all again for joining us, and I hope everybody has a great day.